intelligence information was received that the Japanese were using a museum in the center of the city of Hanoi as their regional headquarters for all of their activity. So we flew down. We decided we would use the tactics of simply ramming or skipping the bombs in to the building itself. And you go in and take a look at 2 days later and see what kind of damage, what the damage looked like. But that damage was, you know, pretty great. It was pretty much burned out. But that was when I was hit by small arms fire and it hit me in the cool. This shot, that just a lucky shot, you know. So I could feel the, and then touched the pressed fluid on my neck, and so I knew that I, you know, I was in trouble. The flame was really coming back toward the cockpit. I was probably about 35 miles from Hanoi, and I hit the ground going sideways, and I broke my right ankle. I heard shouts from behind me, and the shouts were, hey boy, French, French. The part of the colonial government, which was under the control of the Vichy government in France, and in this case, they were part of a French Foreign Legion division, the only French military division that the Japanese permitted the French to maintain in all of Indochina. When I was picked up in this vehicle, yes, they spoke some English, they did, but they were all types of nationalities, and they took me to the little base that they had there, and which was their division headquarters, and a legionnaire major named Tokadze, who was Russian, who was Ukrainian, was chief of intelligence for them, and so he interrogated me. And this was in March of 1945. The French were beginning to play ball more and more with allies, because the war was going against the Japanese. He said, you know what, I could probably expect that I would be taken up to Mount DA'VE, which was not too far up in the nearby foothills, and incarcerated there for the rest of the war. So I asked him, you know, how successful, what were the results of the attack on a Japanese headquarters in Hanoi 2 days ago? And he said, what do you know about that? So I told him, well, that made a lot of difference. And I didn't realize how much at the time. He said that we have for so long been sending information up through the underground of intelligence, on intelligence about the Japanese, that had never been acted upon, and this was the first time it had been acted upon. We're prepared to take you into our little underground headquarters, which is, and he said, we offer to take you around and we'll show you that. Firsthand, the Japanese installation there, and I would dress as a French officer, and you know, we would go to various places, you know, visit the docks at Haiphong, and where the Japanese shipping was pretty active, and the railroad station, and
you didn't speak
and, French. And the airfields that they had two airfields there, and so I accumulated all of this data, maps, and was there for about 10 days doing it. One day they decided we'd go to some French restaurant in downtown Hanoi, and we were at this table, about four of us, and by God, these Japanese came in, officers came in, had their samurai sword drawn on them, and they sat at the table right next to us, and they sort of said a brief hi to, you know, to the French, and I just kept my mouth very shut. And one of the Frenchmen that phoned in, Dasturk, said that I don't fancy that they realize that there's an American airman that they're looking at. It's one night, drinking cognac, listening to some French records on a Victrola, and suddenly mortars started dropping all around us. And the Japanese, like I wrote, put a typical Pearl Harbor. And they invited all of the French dignitaries, civilian and military alike, in both Hanoi and Saigon, to a trumped-up special event. And they simultaneously surrounded all the military fortifications. They did it because they felt that the they knew the French had an underground, and so they just decided that they had enough of this and they were going to knock it off. The Citadel had French officers and families there. About 8 or 10 of the students that had attended the University of Hanoi came to the Citadel that night, and that day, together with 2 or 3 of the legionnaires and this French captain and I, were able to make our way out through a quiet part of the fort, over the wall, and then were able to make our way out of the city. So they were all around on the perimeter, and picked out the quietest place we could, and sort of evaded some of their patrols and vehicle patrols that they had, and so on. It was at night, pitch black, we caught a little boat, and that was a good way to get from cover distance without being on main thoroughfares. We made our way several days towards Son La, which was up in the mountains, between the Black and the River and the Red River. In order to get to the Red River, but there was a road, a main thoroughfare, a route 6 or something like that, and they had it well patrolled. And so this one day, we came to this road, we had to go on to the river farther to the west, and French Captain Disturgs appointed me along with another, one of the students. I ended up with several hand grenades, and I got my 45 back, and Disturgs said, you stay here and cover us, we'll get over to the other side, first chance, and then we'll meet you on the other side. Well, I didn't think that was a very good idea, but anyway, we hit on one side. They crossed the road, and just as they were disappearing on the other side, there was a shot fired. At about the same time, this vehicle came around the bend, a very regular military vehicle with a weapons carrier with 6 or 8 seats on either side in the back, and here were these Japanese troops. And so, without thinking a great deal, first time I ever used a hand grenade, I threw the first hand grenade and hit the engine, and just stopped it cold. And then I fired, threw a second one into the rear of it where the Japanese troops were, real quick. And great confusion. And in the confusion, this other fellow and I scrambled across the road and just ran like crazy. And so we then took the road in a vehicle from Muk Chau up to Son La, very close to Dien Bien Phu. And there the French had 3 of the aircraft that they had, Potez 25s, that they flew in Morocco, North Africa, back in the 30s. And then they wanted to fly me out in this Potez 25. We took off and we sort of spiraled up through this open area. We eventually got to 12,000 feet, and we were on top then, and we started flying north. But it was cold up there, and as we flew north, the higher the tops of the overcast got, and pretty soon we were complete overcast, and there was no visual reference at all. And we flew for about 1 hour and 40 minutes, and we never saw anything, and I knew, we're all going to run out of fuel, we're just going to have to bail out again. I'm a reasonably religious person, and I brought up as a good Catholic, but I have never, ever prayed so hard in all my life. And suddenly, when I was pretty sure we were just about to run out of fuel, there was a little break in the overcast. The pilot just rolled it over and did a very tight, spiraling dive descent. I just didn't think the wings and the fabric would hold together on this aircraft. And we got down to the base of the overcast, was about 2,000 feet. The first thing I saw was a little lake that I identified immediately as being about 10 miles from Nanning, which is where one of our squadrons were located. Thank you.
Tomorrow all the things were gone. I worked for all my life, and I had to start again with just my children and my wife. I thank my lucky stars to be living here today, 'cause the flag still stands for freedom, and they can't take that away. And I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. From the lakes of Minnesota to the hills of Tennessee, across the plains of Texas, from sea to shining sea, from Detroit down to Houston and New York to LA, where there's pride in every American heart, and it's time we stand and say that I'm proud to be an American, where at least I know I'm free. And I won't forget the men who died, who gave that right to me. And I gladly stand up next to you and defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt I love this land. God bless the USA. Defend her still today, 'cause there ain't no doubt.